3, 2, 1. Whoa!
Wait, we already posted this video, right? Yeah, we definitely did. So let's do something different. Today, we're going to talk about how we got to this point. But first, let's go back in time. During the 2017 to 2018 school year, Cyclone Rocketry, or Rocket Shop as it was called back then, was first founded. They had a mission to take collegiate rocketry to new heights, as well as build some really cool rockets. During their first year, they took their rocket to Spaceport America Cup, and they had a very successful launch during their very first attempt.
And from that point on, it was clear that the next big goal for Cyclone Rocketry is to go faster and higher. However, that came with its own problems.
The very first Spaceport America Cup, we wanted to do the 30,000 foot commercial off-the-shelf division. We wanted to come out and go after one of the harder divisions just to show that yes, we're a new team, but we mean business and we're coming out here to compete. Part of the problem with that was the motors we were going to need to purchase were going to cost us into the tens of thousands of dollars, well over the budget of the entire project. In totality though, the overall like main goal I had for the organization, like on a 10-year plan, was that at some point in time, the ISU Rocketry team was going to make its own propulsion, and then also at some point in time, do a space shot. We went from a club of about 20 people to when we started the following year, we had over 200 people sign up. And that was a real big, I guess, indicator of what we had done at Spaceport America. Is we really came out and made a good name for ourselves, in my opinion.
They mentioned at the kickoff meeting on my junior year, so the second year it was a thing, that they were going to have a propulsion team. And I'd worked with Dr. Travis Sipple for my honors project my freshman year on solid rocket propellant. And I was stoked.
You know, I think initially there's a little bit of trepidation when you start talking about rockets and rocket motors and student-built rocket motors and testing them. But I think that all comes from, we all see things on television like SpaceX and Elon Musk and these big bursts of flame and things like that. And so I think maybe initially, just saying, yeah, we're going to build a rocket motor, probably concerned a few people. But I think as people started to understand that students were starting very small, the way I describe it is Cyclone Rocketry thinks big, starts small, and increases incrementally. And that's sort of how they worked their way up to a full-scale rocket motor test.
It was hard to gain people's confidence, like off the bat. So something that we did up front was we went out and we got a lot of certifications in high-powered rocketry. And so we really wanted to show the university that we weren't messing around. And obviously with the type of activity that we were involved in and Cyclone Rocketry is still involved in, there is inherently a lot of risk, right? You're dealing with an explosive device. And so some of the problem we dealt with was showing people that we were capable of undertaking that responsibility.
I was the propulsion team lead for my sophomore year, as well as my junior year, before handing off the kind of reins to Abel during my senior year. You know, definitely when we started out as a propulsion sub team, you know, I definitely was, you know, had a unique perspective just because I was the team lead during that time. And even though it wasn't apparent, I'd say one of the biggest challenges was thinking about the present and our present goals versus what we want to accomplish in the future. You know, from a personnel perspective, you know, I was a sophomore at the time. I was not the smartest person in the room. And so how do you balance between leaning on a lot of juniors, seniors, and I think we had one or two grad students that were partly involved? How do you lean on their experience? Because they're the ones that could actually design, you know, said motor or said something. But they're going to be gone in a year. And so that's not really helpful for our future. But as well as, you know, we have a lot of freshmen and sophomores who and all of us want to get that experience, but we may not necessarily know how to design something properly, or, you know, we don't have the same level of experience. And so how do you balance getting those immediate term goals or short and medium term goals done by leveraging experience, as well as trying to build a future, but you haven't even proven the present yet, because that first year we haven't even tested a motor yet. And so we don't have, you know, we haven't proven ourselves. And so that was a really big struggle to kind of balance that. And then in addition to that, you know, we did a few small scale tests and there were several discussions that we had. We had the ability, and at the time there was some permission around to try and test some bigger motors, which would make us look really good if they went well. But at the same time, if they didn't, we wouldn't really have a foundation to really build from. However, by kind of pushing our timeline back a year or two, we were able to get, I think it's like over 20 different subscale tests completed. And that's, you know, kind of the point of this video is we have this big full scale fire, but even if that didn't go well, we would have such a strong foundation that we could still test again. And so it's just this big interplay, I think, in the first 2 years of focusing on the present to try and make progress versus thinking about a longer term vision without essentially, or by making enough progress such that you don't wreck the longer term vision. I don't know. It sounds convoluted, but it was a really challenging problem that I'd have to ask myself questions about pretty much every day. We had a few successful test fires in the spring of my sophomore year, and a lot of people were getting really excited about us. And then we had one motor failure that it seemed like a lot of people kind of lost, you know, kind of excitement or idea about what we could be, and there's a lot of momentum lost. And then we went to the summer, and I think the biggest achievement was seeing that next semester kind of big turnaround. You know, we had, I think it was like 5 or 6 successful fires that next semester. We had a lot better of a motor. Everyone kind of rallied together. We had started having a culture, in a sense, that we didn't have before. And so at least when I was there, it was that whole semester of just kind of coming back and building, okay, this is a team that's going to be there for a long time. So
I think that COVID played a huge part and kind of taught us a lot about propulsion, a lot about how kind of just how people react to almost when the world shuts down. And I think that it's very kind of not funny, but it's very unique that as a collegiate university team, well, we were able to feel the same stresses, the same problem that industry was facing. So coming into the semester, I was very nervous because I'm like, what if I don't have the resources, you know, that I can't see my members face to face? What if I don't have access to the computer lab so that we're able to do our work? And then so with that, I was a little bit nervous, but I thought to myself, as long as I can keep the excitement about rocketry, I think that we will be able to go really far and still be able to keep the drive and still be able to keep the hype. And so now that's kind of what I did. And then so, you know, we really utilize Zoom a lot, you know, all the virtual platforms, and just being able to have students still be able to see face-to-face, still be able to see projects come together, you know, on CAD and things like that. Towards the end of the semester, I think we got a lot more comfortable, because that first semester, it was new for everybody. It was new for the university, new for the world, new for us. As the second semester rolled around, we kind of got a little more comfortable. You know, the world started kind of changing and going towards a positive way. And then we were able to go back on campus a little bit more. And then so when we were able to get back on campus and group up, we were really just excited to see one another and really work towards that excitement that we built on the first semester about rocketry. So how do we keep, again, how do we keep motivated through our year and kind of about propulsion history? It just being excited, just being excited that this is a crucial stepping stone for us, just to make sure that we keep the hype through.
Well, being in code for a year, it's hard to get stuff done because everyone is remote. So coming back from that, it was actually pretty nice because everybody's very motivated to be in person to get work done. So it actually kind of worked out for us, just because everyone actually wanted to be here. They're eager to, you know, start working on stuff because it's kind of been a year pause. So coming back from that, it's honestly, for the developments this semester, it's probably helped us a lot, just because everyone is so excited to work on stuff. Mm-hmm. So some of the main achievements, I think, during my time at CyROC has been mainly the subscale fires. So those have been huge, because you can only predict what a motor is gonna burn like so much without actually burning it. But once you actually do burn it and measure the thrust, measure the pressure, measure the temperature, you can actually see how close your estimates were. And then kind of going off that subscale testing, the full scale testing. So this is actually the motor that's gonna go in the rocket this year. So that has been definitely one of the biggest achievements, because now we're actually producing a product for the club as a whole. So some of the main challenges, and some of the main challenges with the full-scale motor, because that's been one of the main projects for this semester, has been manufacturing, because, you know, making a motor this big isn't exactly super easy to do. So for the subscale motors in the past, you know, we've used, you know, traditional methods like putting it on a lathe, putting it on a mill, doing all that stuff. But this motor is actually so big it kind of outgrew most of the lathes on campus. So we had to use the biggest lathe we can find on campus. We also had to manufacture some specialized tools to be able to use it with that lathe. So specifically like manufacturing the case, so that's the long cylindrical kind of pressure vessel of the motor. That has definitely been the most difficult to manufacture, so I'd say that's probably the biggest challenge. But then also trying to find a site to actually test motors at, that's also very difficult. So something like this you can't exactly put in your backyard and fire. This is, you know, like 13 pounds of rocket fuel going off at once. So. It's definitely a challenge to find something safe to do it. So I think that's another one of the bigger logistical challenges we faced this year as well.
First of all, you know, the full scale motor test was it was just exciting. You could just sort of feel it. You know, the excitement was palpable. That the students were excited about the fact that they were going to actually do a full scale rocket test. I was paying attention to, you know, the situation to make sure that that the energetics, the propellant, that stuff was all kept off to the side until we were ready and everyone was moved out of the test area, except for the few that were necessary to ready the motor for the test. But I will say, being there for the test, especially when it was finished and it was a successful test, just to watch the excitement and the release of emotion of all those students, that was something to see.
So going into the full-scale motor test, it was very stressful. So you know, it always comes down to like the day before kind of stuff. You're always trying to grind out as much as you can. So the night before, we were almost doing a dry run. So a couple weeks prior, we went out to the site, set everything up, made sure the data acquisition system worked, and everything worked perfectly. So then the night before the test, we did the same exact thing, but just in our own site. And so we were testing out electronics, and then just stuff stopped working, of course. So we had to improvise a little bit. We had to, you know, find some spare parts and stuff to get it working. But eventually, by the end of the day, we had everything working. So then the day of, we all got to our site very early, and we just started setting up. And so we got the motor in, we were starting to hook up the instrumentation. We haven't loaded the propellant in because we put the case in before we put the propellant in. So we have yet to put the propellant in, but we are testing out our instrumentation. And then, of course, at the site, we're getting ready to fire, it just stops working. So then we have to delay and delay and delay for like an hour or two. And we finally get it working to a state where we're confident to test the motor out. So then we load the propellant in. Everyone's very stressed because we don't really know if the instrumentation is going to stop working again. Because if the instrumentation stops working, we test the motor. We essentially just tested out a $500 motor for nothing. So very stressful. But then we had the confirmation that the instrumentation was working. So we fired the motor, and luckily everything worked as planned. The motor worked. We got all instrumentation data that matched up with our predictions very well. After that, we were all very, very happy because everything worked as planned, and the stress in the end was all worth it. So,
3, 2, 1.
So that feeling, as soon as the motor went off, it was unreal. I mean, you know, I can list off a bunch of adjectives on, you know, how on how it felt, but I don't think that really truly captures on what it felt. You know, just seeing it, just seeing the exhaust plume come, just the sound that it was making, it was almost like 4 years just accumulating into that one exhaust plume. Just seeing everything behind the works, you know, from computer, from simulation to small scale testing, to seeing manufacturing, just seeing everybody putting together the long hours that nobody sees, and for it to come together in less than 5 seconds. I mean, it is just incredible. I mean, it was unreal, and it was a huge accomplishment, and just a huge, again, just great for Cyclone Rocketry, great for propulsion, great for Iowa State.
I think people on the outside of propulsion look into propulsion, and not that they see it as a big waste, but they see us as, you know, experimenting with these very dangerous devices and stuff, and we're undergrads, so we're not professionals by any means. But I think going off of all our subscale testing and going off of all our just testing in general, pressure vessel testing, hydrostatic testing, that sort of stuff, I'm very confident the payoff from this final full-scale test was most certainly worth all the effort it took, just because we know that this system is very safe and very reliable. Even though we've tested it once so far, we know that it's probably going to work in the future. And I think that just having a device this powerful is it bodes very well for the club as a whole, just because now we can say that we've made pretty much every part of the rocket. You know, we're making tubes now for aerostructures. Now we can make our own rocket motors. This is huge. So essentially saying we built everything ourselves. So I think this is very much worth all the effort it took, even though it took 3 years and a ton of blood, sweat, and tears to get it to happen. But in the end, I think it was all worth it. But this is obviously like a huge development for us. So I think what's next on the table is, again, testing this a couple times to make sure it's actually reliable and robust enough to go into rocket. But also manufacturing even bigger motors. So in the future, you know, we're going to want to make rockets that go to 30K and rockets that go even higher. And that's going to need an even bigger motor to do. So I think we're actually going to probably start manufacturing and testing some even bigger motors this semester for future rockets.
No, I think the next big milestone is just to be able to prove that we are comfortable working at these larger scale motors. And then so if that means doing a couple full scale tests again, maybe changing our propellant formulation a little bit. But I think working at this size right now, it really, I think, gives propulsion subteam the confidence that we need on going even bigger if you want to go into an 8-inch diameter rocket, which would take a 150 millimeter motor. And then so again, kind of going back to what I said on my last point, just being able just to keep learning, you know, keep diving into the textbook, keep reaching out to resources, you know, like our advisor, Dr. Sipple, just us gaining the competency and then always reflecting like, hey, we need to make sure we do this safe. We need to make sure that we account, you know, for two times what we're going to experience. You know, we need to make sure our factor safety is, you know, we need to make sure we go under rigorous design reviews, just because that's only going to give us more confidence and give our advisors more confidence too.
Boy, I had no idea what to expect from Cyclone Rocketry. You remember when I got into this, I didn't know them. They didn't know me. It takes time to establish dialogue and trust and things along that line. I often tell people when I'm working with Cyclone Rocketry that I'm the dumbest person in the room. You know, I'm saying that kind of tongue in cheek, but I am surrounded by very, very bright students that are doing some really amazing things. So I'm very impressed with them, and I like that they're willing to work with me and the safety department to assure that this is done safely, and so that everyone comes away from the experience unharmed. Well, you know, I've only been with Cyclone Rocketry for 3 years, and in that time, I've seen so many students graduate and go on to work for NASA, Rockwell Collins, and SpaceX, and places like that. So, I think in the future, what I really look forward to is I know someday there's going to be some big space launch, some historic event, and somewhere I'm going to look at a picture and I'm going to see someone, I'm going to recognize them. They're going to be, you know, they were former students that were part of this. So this is one of those things where the sum is greater than the parts.